I extend a very warm welcome to the students and staff from the University of Stirling, all of whom are studying housing, who have joined us in the public gallery this morning. Everyone present is reminded to switch off mobile phones as they affect the broadcasting system. As meeting papers are provided in digital format, you may see tablets being used during the meeting. Apologies have been received from David Stewart. Agenda Item 1, Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill. The committee will take oral evidence on the Private Housing Tenancies Scotland Bill at Stage 1 from Margaret Burgess, Minister for Housing and Welfare, Barry Stalker, Head of Private Rented Sector Strategy and Private Tenancies Bill Team, and Kirsten Simonnet-Lefevre, Principal Legal Officer at the Scottish Government. Can I firstly welcome the Minister and officials and ask the Minister if she would like to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. The bill will introduce a new private residential tenancy which will improve security, stability and predictability for tenants while providing safeguards for landlords, lenders and investors. The private rented sector now plays a vital role in meeting Scotland's housing needs. This government recognised this when we published our strategy for the sector in 2013, and this was the first strategy for private renting in Scotland and was developed in partnership with stakeholders. In it, we set out our vision for a private rented sector that provides good quality homes and high management standards, inspires consumer confidence and encourages growth through attracting increased investment. To achieve this, the Scottish Government has undertaken a range of actions to improve private renting, and this includes clarifying the existing law and charging of premium fees so that tenants can't be charged for getting a tenancy, setting up the tenancy deposit schemes in Scotland to protect tenancy deposits, legislating to create a new tribunal for private renting, legislating to regulate the letting agent industry, providing local authorities with additional enhanced powers to tackle bad practice where this occurs. But to deliver the better quality, more professional sector that we set out to achieve, we need to do more than this. We need to rebalance the relationship between landlords and tenants to one that is fairer for both and that works in today's private rented sector. Change is never easy, but sometimes it's necessary, and I believe that the changes from this bill is necessary in order to make private renting better for everyone. This will be a modern, open-ended tenancy. There will not be a no-fault ground. Instead, landlords will use new grounds for repossession, which cover all the reasonable circumstances they would need. Rents will also be more predictable with adjudication provided where rent increases take rent beyond the market rate. Local authorities will also be able to apply for rent pressure zone designation where rent increases in a local area are having a detrimental impact on tenants and housing. I want all tenants to feel more settled in their homes and communities. This will benefit families, but also many other tenants, including young people, people with caring responsibilities, and more vulnerable people as well. Tenants should be able to assert their rights where necessary without fear of arbitrary eviction, such as to be able to ask their landlord to carry out necessary repairs. And I believe that the new tenancy will provide a step change in improving the quality of private renting by changing that relationship. And that's not just my belief. I recently received a letter from Shelter Scotland giving their full support for the core principles in the bill. I also recognise that landlords must also feel confident in their ability to effectively manage and regain possession of their property. If they don't have that confidence, there is a risk that some might leave the sector, and this is something that I would want to avoid. That's why it's so important to ensure that we get the balance right and that the grounds for repossession will work for landlords as well. And we've considered the grounds carefully, including what should be mandatory or discretionary. And as part of our consultation, we've increased the number of grounds from 8 to 16. The first-tier tribunal will play a key role in dealing with disputes under the new tenancy. The creation of the tribunal has been widely supported by both tenants and landlords' representatives. It will provide a more accessible, specialist form of redress. Where a ground is mandatory, the tribunal will still need to establish whether it has been met. Landlords will need to provide evidence in support of an application. So let me be clear, simply saying they intend to meet a ground will not be adequate proof. In most cases, tenants will end the tenancy, and this is what happens now under the current tenancy, and I expect this will continue. But where a landlord brings a tenancy to an end and this is disputed, then an application will need to be made to the tribunal. But let me assure the committee, sanctions will apply should a landlord mislead a tenant into leaving their home or the first-tier tribunal into issuing an eviction order. Some of these are set out in the bill as they are specific to the new tenancy, but criminal sanctions such as for illegal eviction will also continue to apply. The government will also ensure that tenants are made fully aware of their rights. For instance, we will include information about tenants' rights and where to seek advice in the notices prescribed under the new tenancy. I know that enforcement has been raised during the committee evidence sessions as a particular concern, and I want to reassure the committee that we will continue to work with local authorities to improve enforcement of existing regulation in the sector. Shortly, we will be consulting on new statutory guidance for local authorities on landlord registration to deliver tougher, more targeted enforcement. And we will continue to work with our partners, COSLA and local authorities, to ensure that the private rented sector is regulated effectively and robustly. But these are broader matters of policy. This bill is about rebalancing the relationship between tenants and landlords. Clearly, as in any case where a balance is struck, this will not suit everyone entirely. Some will want to go further, some will want less change, and getting this right isn't easy. Overall, we have sought to strike a fair balance in what is being proposed in the bill and to ensure that the new tenancy will support a well-functioning, modern sector that works for both tenants and landlord. The government has undertaken extensive consultation and carefully developed this policy to make sure that we get the balance right. I've already outlined the work we're doing to create a better, more professional rented sector, and this new tenancy is absolutely key to achieving that.
Okay, thank you very much, Minister. Perhaps I could kick off our session. You said that the aim of the bill was to rebalance the relationship between tenants and landlords, but can you explain why you think the government has got the balance right, notwithstanding the fact that this is always going to be a delicate balance to achieve? Yeah. Because clearly we've received a range of evidence from a variety of stakeholders, with some, as you alluded to, such as Alacho and the Governed Law Centre, suggesting that the government hadn't gone far enough in favour of tenants, while of course the Scottish Association of Landlords and the Council of Letting Agents suggesting perhaps that the government had gone too far. So can you explain why you think the government has it right?
I think it's right, as you say, Convener, it is a very fine balance, and getting it right isn't easy, but we consulted widely in this bill and we have been consulting on it for some time, and it is part of what we're trying to achieve for the sector. But I think, you know, you said yourself the evidence has shown some say we're going too far one way, some say we're going too far the other way, and I think that in itself says we perhaps have got it right. We are somewhere in between that, and that's what we're seeking to achieve. We want to just get that right. It hasn't been an easy thing. We're not going to please everyone in this, but we do think we have got that balance. We have struck it right.
Okay. The committee has heard that if the Scottish Government wished to specifically target bad practice from landlords and letting agents, then the more appropriate route might have been stronger enforcement of existing legislation. And this morning you've said that new statutory guidance on tougher enforcement will be brought forward by the government. Could the existing enforcement measures not solve many of the problems and the issues that the government is seeking to address in this bill?
No, I don't think it could. This bill is trying to do something quite different. This bill is creating a modern tenancy agreement, which and providing stability and security for tenants and predictability in rents, and the landlord enforcement would not be able to do that on its own. I think they're complementary to each other. I do think we can do more in landlord enforcement, and we're working hard at that. That's also about improving standards in the sector. But I think what this bill does is bring the tenancy agreement into the 21st century, and that's what we're trying to achieve.
Thank you. Obviously, we've got a very tight timescale for the passage of this legislation. Can you say anything about the timescale for publishing the new statutory guidance?
The statutory guidance for landlord enforcement, yeah. Well, it sits separately, obviously, from this legislation that we're taking through, but We're consulting on that, I believe, at the end of the year.
End of the year.
And we're consulting on that, and it would be consultant right into 2016. So I don't know if one of you would like to say when we're planning to have that.
It's our intention to have the new guidance ready and available from spring next year.
Okay. So that'll be available for
local authorities.
Sector to make use of. That's great. Thank you. Alex, you have some questions.
Thank you very much. Excuse me. I wanted to talk specifically about the issue of student accommodation and how that will be affected. Now, we've had a number of representations from people who are involved in the provision of student accommodation on a business model that includes using that accommodation as a holiday let at times a year when the students aren't actually using it. How does the Minister respond to the concerns that we've heard? And does she think that a business case has been made for exempting student lets in the private sector entirely from the new tenancy regime?
I think what we looked at, and we consulted widely on this and spoke to student groups as well, that we wanted to have a tenancy that was the same across the sector, whether it be someone, whether they be students or whether they're not in the student sector. We did introduce a new ground for eviction if someone ceases to be a student in purpose-built student accommodation. We have had a number of representations from the purpose-built student accommodation sector. We think that practices can be changed because students may not want to stay throughout the period. Very clear that within this bill, what we're wanting landlords to be aware of as well, that when they let accommodation to someone, it is their home, and we want people to feel that the private sector is their home. But there has been, as you say, representation from the purpose-built student accommodation sector, and I'm still considering that and looking at what they're saying to us. On purpose-built accommodation.
Yeah. Would the Minister consider perhaps a ground for eviction for student accommodation not related to the status of the landlord but related to the status of the tenant as a student?
I wouldn't be minded to do that. I would be more minded to look at the look again at the purpose-built student accommodation. I wouldn't, at the moment, I'm not minded to look at somebody as a student and say that's a ground in itself for eviction. I am considering the student sector at the moment. It is something that we are looking at and looking very carefully about what stakeholders have said about it. And clearly I'll be interested in what the committee report says in student accommodation. But I'm not minded to make students being a student a ground for eviction.
The accommodation that's owned by the universities is exempted from the legislation. According to my reading of the bill, would it be conceivable that accommodation which is privately owned but entirely used as student accommodation could be treated in the same way as accommodation owned by universities?
The reason why accommodation owned by universities in some ways has been excluded, it's kind of sits separately because the Scottish Funding Council are involved and it's non-charitable, non-profit-making, and felt it appropriate to exempt them. As I said, I am looking at the purpose-built student accommodation. I do understand that it provides the same type of accommodation for the same purposes, and that's why I'm willing to kind of look at that and look again at all the evidence we've received on that.
Would it be your intention in considering that to take into account the fact that we have seen significant improvements in the student accommodation that's available, but that has been largely based on investment attracted by a business model which may cease to exist under this legislation?
That's one of the reasons why I'm looking at this very carefully and looking at what evidence has been produced so far, what the stakeholders are telling us, and obviously what the committee say in their stage one report. But we are giving that a considerable amount of thought.
Thank you very much.
Okay, Claire.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you mentioned that one of the key things in that will give tenants more security going forward is the removal of the no-fault ground. But in evidence, we've heard that The removal of this flexibility in the sector may dissuade landlords from investing, and I was just wondering what your response is to that and how you would reassure them that investment in the private sector will continue to be a sound investment going forward.
I think a number of things. Certainly don't see that as something that will put landlords off investing in the sector. We're very clear in this bill that it is about making the sector better, making it more attractive to let their properties to. And removing the no-fault ground just simply means that landlords can't, for any arbitrary reason, just ask tenants to leave simply because a tenancy has come to an end. So we have included 16 grounds where landlords can reasonably get their property back. And we think that that is sufficient. And I don't think there's been a huge amount of evidence in telling us that the no-fault ground, removing that, has been very well supported across student representative groups, tenant representative groups have very much supported what we're doing in the no-fault ground. Local authorities are supporting what we're doing in the no-fault ground. So I do think that that's central to what we're doing in making and creating a modern tenancy. And I noticed that the chair of the review group has also said he thinks this is a good step forward in how Douglas Robertson, Professor Douglas Robertson, and how we are bringing the private rented sector into a modern tenancy regime.
Welcome the Minister's reassurance in that area, but Gary Moan, who was appointed by Homes for Scotland as a sort of PRS champion, has raised concerns that there may be unintended consequences around the purpose-built student sector, the end of this and the end of the no-fault grounds for eviction, and also the issue of rent control areas may make Scotland less attractive for investment. We also had measures put through in the budget last week with regards to mortgages for buy-to-let properties. Do you have a concern that there may be an impact on the sector going forward at all from this change?
I don't think with what we're proposing in the bill. I think what you mentioned there, which was not happening at the moment in Scotland, what was announced in the budget last week about mortgages for buy-to-lets may put people off investing in the sector. In the rest of the UK or in England, and that's not happening here at this stage, that applies in England. So what I would say is that, yes, we work very closely with Jerry Moore, who is the private sector champion, who we funded Homes for Scotland to appoint the private rented sector champion. We're working hard with him, and I know he has said it could, his words were, it could put Scotland off, put Scotland at a disadvantage. However, we're doing other things and working with Jerry as well to look at ways of attracting investment into the private sector. We're looking at rental income guarantees. We've already, the chief planner has written to every local authority telling them about the importance of the private rented sector when they're looking at the housing needs and demand assessment in their area. So we're doing a lot to encourage the private sector, and like everything else, there's two sides to every coin. For as many people have said, it will put off investors. We're also getting people telling us, and organisations and investors telling us, that it won't put them off. What we're proposing, as currently proposed in the bill, will not detract investment. So we'll get both sides of the story, and it's back to getting the balance. And we think we've got the balance. We think it's proportionate, what we're proposing.
Thank you, Minister.
You make it.
Thank you. Morning, Minister. A number of the stakeholders representing tenants' interests have said that all of the eviction grounds, or at least more of them, should be discretionary, so that the tribunal has got an opportunity to assess the reasonableness of a particular eviction according to the circumstances of the individual case. I wonder what your thoughts are on that.
Well, a couple of things. We're back to getting this balance right, you know, what is right for tenants and what's right for landlords. And we're very clear that landlords have to be able to regain their property in certain circumstances. But I would say what I said in my opening remarks, it is simply not a case, and the grounds are mandatory, that a landlord goes to the tribunal and says, this ground, you know, I want to reclaim my property on this ground. The tribunal will have to look at the evidence. They will have to be sure that the ground has been established. So if I could give an example, in refurbishment, it was, you know, if a landlord is going and saying, I want to refurbish my property and I want to, you know, I've issued a notice and the tenant won't leave, the tribunal will have to look at what is this refurbishment such that the tenant has to be displaced and move out the property while the refurbishment's taking place. They will need to establish that there is real ground for the tenant to vacate the premises to allow the landlord to carry out the work they're saying they're doing. And we're certainly looking at ways of how we can make that clearer, either in the face of the bill or in, you know, legislation sitting under it, that it is absolutely clear that it is not just simply a tick box exercise, that grounds have to be established, even mandatory grounds. The tribunal has to be satisfied that that ground has been met.
And if I could just, as a brief follow-up on that then, if a landlord was to say that I intend, you know, this property to become the home of a family member, how would the tribunal establish whether or not that was actually the case, or that was just a spurious grounds to get rid of a tenant?
I think I'll say a couple of things, and I can't sort of preempt, you know, how the tribunal will act and what they look at. But they will be experts in the field. They will have to look at the evidence that's put in. You know, just I want to move a family member in. As I say, it's not a tick box. I would have to give information of the, you know, details. I can't preempt what the tribunal will say. But we're also consulting on, if a landlord gives a misleading statement to a tribunal to create an offence of £5,000, I think £5,000, we're looking at a fine, a penalty, and a landlord, should they give misleading statements to a tribunal. So it's part of an overall picture about a landlord being a fit and proper person to carry out business of being a landlord. And I do think that, and if a tenant later is established that that ground hasn't been met or the tenant was misled, the tenant will have the compensation ground in the tribunal where a tenant can be compensated up to 3 months' rent. And that's in addition to any other penalties for the landlord for illegal eviction or for giving a false statement to a tribunal and being a fit and proper person to be a landlord. So I do think there's a lot of in this that will make landlords think twice before they use spurious cases to try and remove a tenant that shouldn't be removed. And I think in most cases landlords appreciate that and, you know, manage their properties well, but those that don't, I think that there's a lot of legislation that can certainly put penalties on them for doing something that is not according to the what we are trying to do here.
Thank you. And moving now to the business of rent arrears, the Shelter Scotland, along with some of the other stakeholders representing tenants' interests, have argued strongly that the rent arrear grounds has got a disproportionate effect on tenants in its current form and needs to be amended. They point out, for instance, that, you know, a tenant that maybe got into arrears in their initial first month but hadn't succeeded in catching up within the three-month period, they may have met the next couple of months' payments, may, you know, be disproportionately affected by this, and that neither tenants nor landlords may, you know, really wish to seek an eviction, but it would create a grounds for eviction. Do you feel there's some further work required there?
I think a couple of things. Rent arrears is absolutely a key issue for landlords and sometimes for the viability of their business or the tenancy. They might have the mortgage fees to pay and require the rent coming in to do that. So I think we have to get the balance right there. And landlords need to be clear that they can recover their property and effectively manage it. But rent arrears is also a problem for tenants, and that's absolutely recognised as well. Many who could be in financial hardship. So it's our intention that, you know, tenants are provided with advice, where to get money advice, how to, you know, as soon as they fall into arrears. However, there is a three-month period. So what we're what we're saying in the bill is that over a three-month period, if rent arrears add up to a full month's rent, then that could be a mandatory ground for eviction. However, if that's caused because of a delay in benefits that's out with the fault of the tenant, then that ground has not been met. So it's not a mandatory ground in those circumstances. So there is opportunity in that 3 months for a tenant to catch up with some of the arrears, pay up, you know, make arrangements with the landlord. The landlord doesn't have to automatically evict somebody that has a rent arrears. The landlord could issue the notice to leave for rent arrears and say if the arrears are not cleared by 3 months, within 3 months, then I will take the case to the tribunal. But within that period, there's opportunity for the tenant to work with the landlord and make arrangements to repay the arrears. And the landlord does not have to take the case to the tribunal at the end of that. And many landlords currently don't in the private sector as well. They work with arrangements with their tenants to ensure that the arrears are reducing and the tenant can remain in the property. But we have to give landlords that ability to reclaim their property because, you know, it's their business. And some of them have no other way of recovering that if the tenant continually doesn't pay their rent. So we think we've struck the balance right there with that 3 month period.
Yeah, just one further point, Minister, on this issue, and it's that some landlords have complained that there's no mechanism within the bill to deal with tenants who make persistently late payments, albeit that they eventually pay. Does that cause you any concern?
I think if you have tenants that persistently make their payments late and make their payments, you're right, there isn't anything currently in the bill that would cover that period. What the bill covers is rent arrears that have not been paid, a month's rent arrears that are outstanding in a three-month period. If somebody paying their rent late every month, it doesn't accrue to a month in a three-month period, but the landlord's getting their money, then currently there isn't anything in the bill that would cover that as long as the landlord is getting their rent.
Thank you.
Okay, clear.
I can ask, we've taken a bit of evidence on antisocial behaviour and the grounds for eviction surrounding that. But during our evidence on the 18th of November, some of the witnesses described this ground as mandatory, whereas the material associated with this bill describes it as discretionary, which has led to a little bit of confusion. So, for the record, Minister, could you just give us your understanding of the nature of the antisocial behaviour ground within the bill?
The antisocial behaviour ground is a discretionary ground within the bill. The landlord will have to establish that antisocial behaviour in the tribunal can determine and evidence in front of them if it goes to a tribunal, if the landlord has enough grounds to evict an antisocial behaviour purposes, is discretionary.
Thank you for that clarification, Minister. Some of the witnesses representing the landlord groups have expressed concern that landlords would no longer be able to effectively tackle behaviour of antisocial tenants because, as in many of these cases, neighbours and co-tenants would be fearful about giving evidence before a tribunal. How do you respond to those concerns from the landlords?
First thing I would say, we all understand and appreciate the alarm and distress caused by antisocial behaviour. It is not acceptable. It is not acceptable in the private sector. It is not acceptable in the social sector. And we understand the difficulties it causes for people. However, I do think it's right that it has to be established, that there has to be a process followed before somebody loses their home for antisocial behaviour. And as it currently stands, it's very arbitrary in the private sector. They can ask somebody to leave simply because the lifestyle is different. It may not be antisocial behaviour. It could be it's an arbitrary decision. And I think for asking people to leave their home, evict people, then there has to be established grounds of antisocial behaviour. So the tribunal will look at the evidence in front of them. Now, the tribunal is not as formal and as adversarial as a court, but they will have to have evidence. They'll have to see what is presented to them. And it may not be that they will call witnesses of neighbours. There may be sufficient evidence with what the landlord provides. There could be statements. There could be a variety of things. It will be ultimately up to the tribunal to decide if that ground has been met. But I think it allows landlords to manage their properties effectively. I think it gives tenants an opportunity to state their case as well, if it's been suggested in some ways that they're behaving in an antisocial way, they're entitled to their side of the story as well. So I don't think that this is going to cause any great difficulties for landlords in the current any more than the current system does for landlords. It also means if somebody within early on in a tenancy just now, it would have to wait till the tenancy run to the end, and the landlord might not just renew it, but if there was evidence very early on in a tenancy, a landlord would be able to issue a notice to leave for antisocial behaviour. So I do think that it's fair and it's proportionate.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you.
Siobhan, did you have a supplementary?
Yeah. It was due to Claire Anderson's first question, and obviously it's helpful that you've said antisocial behaviour is discretionary. That part, because there has been a lot of discussion about what is meant by it. Can you maybe explain why that you've taken the decision to put it as discretionary? Because a lot of people have been calling for it, particularly the landlord, for it to be mandatory. So it would be helpful to know your thought process on that.
It's been discretionary since we published the bill, and it's discretionary because it's about fairness and to kind of. I think antisocial behaviour has got to be demonstrated. It's got to be demonstrated. There's got to be evidence that this behaviour is antisocial and is causing problems for neighbours. And is there something that can be put right? For example, sometimes it may well be that there's something, I don't know, mediation, whatever, that can actually sort an antisocial behaviour problem. And is the behaviour so bad that a person requires to be evicted? Some people will. The tribunal will in some cases say, no, what I've seen here, this evidence, this is not acceptable. You're absolutely right. We're going to issue an eviction order. In other cases, the tribunal may say, no, they might ask them to come back at a later stage if the behaviour persists. But there are some circumstances a tenant could say, for example, look, I'm sorry, I was out of order, I'm willing to look at this, I'm willing to talk. So there's a whole range of things, but I think it's about fairness, and it's about establishing the grounds. Is this antisocial or is it not? And certainly under the current system, I just don't think it's right that a landlord can just make a decision that very arbitrary without any evidence that somebody has committed antisocial behaviour.
We've heard the evidence from the landlords that they're concerned that maybe neighbours wouldn't put themselves forward to go to a tribunal because that person then may not be found guilty of antisocial behaviour and return to, say, it's a block of flats and cause disruption. Then is that a concern to you at all?
I think that applies across the board, though, in antisocial behaviour, whether it be in the social sector or the private sector. And I think what we need to, we certainly have to be clear, antisocial behaviour is not acceptable anywhere. But it may well be that we're the tribunal may not feel the need to call witnesses or to call tenants, because to know about antisocial behaviour, somebody has got to have told the landlord anyway, whether it be a neighbour, whether it be generally is a neighbour that has reported the case, the situation to a landlord in whatever sector. So they have spoken out in some ways. A tribunal may not think that they're required to call people as witnesses. landlord may want to take witnesses along with them, and if they're willing to go, that's fine. The tenant may want to go and speak in their behalf. So it will depend on the tribunal, and it will depend on the circumstances as well, what it is. But I mean, I do understand that people can be reluctant to do that because fearful for themselves, but depending what the behaviour is, and if it is frightening and intimidating, and the evidence can show to that extent, then I think the tribunal will do the right thing.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. And just on the theme of other grounds for evictions, a number of stakeholders have said it shouldn't be a mandatory ground of eviction that a landlord has ceased to be registered, for example. Wrongly, they say, penalises tenants for landlords' failings. Are you persuaded by this view? Is this something you might consider in terms of...
Something we're clearly looking at in terms of... Because there's a number of issues. If a landlord ceases to be registered, then they're not a fit and proper person to be a landlord. So how long do you allow a tenant to remain in a property that's got a landlord that's not fit and proper? We're looking at this. We're looking at this to get something that... perhaps is a bit clearer than what we're trying to do here, because it's about the balance. I don't know if you want to say something on this from the legal perspective.
Yes, it's where it's an indefinite tenancy. We felt that if the landlord was not a fit and proper person and was not registered, then there had to be a way to bring the situation to a conclusion. And having a ground to evict in that instance does bring it to a conclusion if the landlord does not change his behaviour and become registered again.
Unfortunately, that seems to penalise the tenant, though, rather than the landlord for the bad behaviour or the poor performance. And I understand this ground hadn't actually been consulted upon prior to the introduction of the bill. Could you explain why you brought that in without consultation?
I think there was a number of things there. When we our first consultation, we had 8 grounds for eviction. In our second consultation, we had 11 grounds for eviction. And by listening to stakeholders and other pieces of evidence, that's why it wasn't specifically consulted on. But I do think we have to look at this. I absolutely take your point you're making. This is not the tenant's fault that the landlord perhaps... fails to be registered, but if a landlord loses their registration, it's because they're behaving in a way that they're not fit to be a landlord, and they have a property, and in some instances a local authority can put a rent penalty notice on which they're not allowed to rent. So if a tenant was there, and how, so that we're looking at this to see if we can get this in a way that's better, but we absolutely understand that it could be through no fault of the tenant, but in some other circumstances, likewise, if a landlord wants to sell their house or bring a family member in, that's not the tenant's fault, and we understand that. But if a landlord has bad behaviour, it's going to impact on that landlord in terms of their registration. There could be penalties on the landlord and their business and how they, you know, whether they continue as a business. So it would be about looking and working with the landlord to see if they can change their practice and be a registered landlord, and we have to look at that. But indefinitely, I think the point where we can't have somebody living in a property indefinitely with a landlord that's not fit and proper to manage that property.
Yes, but this is an area of the bill.
This is an area that we're looking at to kind of get a strike the balance a bit different.
Yeah. Okay. The next point was in terms of landlords' intentions. Now, I think you've already covered that with your answers on refurbishment, and Mike McKenzie had asked about another family member, the ground for moving somebody in. Could I ask if guidance is going to be produced in some detail over these particular landlord intention eviction grounds? Is there something that people can refer to easily?
I think we'll be providing guidance for landlords anyway, but I think we're also looking if we can do something and would be very open to any suggestions on this, how we can make this clearer in the bill, that we cannot instruct the tribunal what to do, but we can look at how we can make this clearer, what we're saying by intention, and how, and make it absolutely clear that the landlord has still got to evidence what they're saying to a tribunal. And I'm very clear that any notice to leave that goes to a tenant is very clear that's of the rights on it about the tribunal, and they can, if they think this is dispute what the landlord's saying or think it's spurious, they can take the case to the tribunal, and where they can get assistance to do that as well. I think it's very clear that this is not a case of the notice is issued, the tenant leaves, and then it transpires that it was all... Yeah, exactly. So we want to be absolutely clear that tenants know their rights and encouraged to exercise their rights and know where to get help to do that, as well as trying to, if we can, get change, you know, get this clearer on the bill. And we're looking at it. We are actually looking at how can we make this absolutely clearer and a bit more confidence. I mean, I appreciate members, you know, it's all right for somebody to say, oh, we intend to sell the property or we intend to move a family member in. So that's mandatory, so that's fine. You know, the notice will be granted. It's only going to be granted if the grounds are established, and the mandatory grounds have to be established as well. But if we can make that clearer, we'll certainly do so. And if the committee has any suggestions how we can make it clearer, we'll certainly look at that as well.
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Alex.
Thanks very much, Convener. Some stakeholders have argued that ground six relating to employees is too narrow, particularly if you think of it in the context of a rural business. Instead, it's been suggested that there should be a ground which allows eviction where property is needed to house a new employee, regardless of what the property is currently being used for. Do you think the case has been made for a broader formulation of the relevant ground?
No, I don't think so. We have the ground if someone ceases to be an employee, that's a ground for regaining the property. But one of the issues in rural areas, particularly rural areas, was the security of the tenure. And this new tenancy helps to address that. And I would be concerned that in a rural area, if a family were moved on to bring, and were evicted basically, to bring someone else into the tenancy, whether it be an employee or not, that would cause me concerns. You could have a family there, they're in a rural school that's part of the community, and they've been asked to leave to bring an employee in. I think their holiday lets don't come into the situation. I think employers, you know, have to look at their properties and how they manage it. And I know that this might be difficult for them as well, but I think we have to look at it. If the purpose of this is to allow people security of tenure and to live in the private sector as their home and somewhere they regard as their home, then I think it would be unfair in a rural situation to say that a family can be moved on to bring an employee in. And I think if one employee moves, there's the opportunity, you know, they can be asked to leave because they're no longer an employee. We put that in listening to the legislation. But I'm not persuaded that to ask people to leave to bring it for an employee is the right way to do it. And in terms of short-term holiday lets, some employers use that and can use that to turn over their employees. So I think there's other ways that they can do it. But no, I'm not persuaded on that one.
Thank you. The final thing I wanted to ask is about sort of grounds that are not included within the 16 that have been suggested ought to be. For example, there's been suggestions that there needs to be something to deal with the situation where a tenant has died or where a tenant has simply disappeared. Also, a suggestion that something to deal with a situation where a tenant has served a notice to leave but has failed to vacate the property. Can I ask if the Minister has any comments about whether there's a prospect for some additional grounds to deal with that sort of situation?
I'm not convinced there's any prospect for additional grounds to deal with the kind of issues that you mentioned. Well, on the one, on the death one, we had provision that the bereaved a bereaved partner can succeed the tenancy. I think there are arguments in the situation of the death one that we need to look at again. For example, it could be disadvantageous to both the family of the deceased person and to the landlord the way we have it currently in the bill. So we might have, you know, we are actively looking at bringing forward amendment at stage two that would bring the tenancy to an end if there is no bereaved partner to take over. So that would perhaps resolve that particular point that you raised. But in terms of a tenant who issues a notice to leave and then subsequently stays on in the premises, they then no longer have a tenancy at the end of their notice. They're no longer a tenancy, and they're illegally occupying the property, and that would be the Sheriff Court that would have to step in there, because they're not a tenant that can be taken to the tribunal. The tenancy would effectively be at an end, and it would be up to the Sheriff Court to eject them, basically, for being in premises unlawfully or illegally.
Thank you.
Adam.
Yes, just on eviction grounds during the initial period, which are restricted to, I think, six grounds. We've had people like the Council of Letting Agents arguing there should be additional eviction grounds to be used during the initial period. For example, when a tenant has abandoned the property. What do you make of that suggestion, Minister?
I think I'm at the moment very carefully looking at the evidence that's come both to the committee and to ourselves on the initial tenancy and the grounds and how it would operate. So that is something that I'm currently giving further consideration to. And you know, welcome any comments and suggestions on that as how we proceed with that, because there have been some, you know, cases made, for example, the abandonment one. Are the grounds sufficient? Is the initial tenancy meeting the purpose that we intended it to meet at the outset of the bill? So that's something that we're certainly actively considering just now, and I'm open to suggestions on that one.
Okay. Thank you for that. Can I move on to wrongful termination? Some stakeholders have suggested that the compensation paid to tenants for wrongful termination should be higher than the 3 months' rent. I think you've explained that this wouldn't be the only penalty that to be faced by a landlord, but 3 months' rent doesn't appear to be a great sum in terms of the impact on the tenant, for example.
I think we looked at the 3 months' rent, and clearly it depends what the rent is in a property, but we felt that 3 months' rent would be sufficient to allow the tenant to find other accommodation, pay a deposit in other accommodation, and it kind of lets the landlord know this is something that you shouldn't do, and there's other penalties on the landlord. I'm not sure, because compensation has got to sort of be based on what has been lost. And I think that's why we came at that figure. We felt that was a reasonable figure. We felt it was a figure that the tenant could probably recover from the landlord. And made our intention clear that we weren't prepared to have wrongful evictions. And also, I think that with the other penalties that the landlord can face, I think will deter landlords from doing that as well, because what we want is landlords not to do that. We don't want people to be wrongfully evicted. We want people to be able to stay in their home. We want it to be their home. And we want to encourage landlords to recognise we're serious about this. So that was why we came to the 3 months figure. We felt that was reasonable compensation.
Okay. But obviously people in that situation, tenants who are being evicted, as it were, in those circumstances, they obviously have pressing priorities to find another home, for example. So they might not necessarily take a case to the tribunal. And it's been put to us by people like Homeless Action Scotland, suggesting that third parties, such as local authorities, should be able to bring cases to the tribunal on behalf of tenants. Is that something you would consider?
No, it's not something I've considered in terms of the tribunal. What I think we've got to be clear, and we're always going to advise tenants of their rights and what they can do, and I think that's important. There'll be a model tenancy agreement as well. I think that's important that we do that, but I think any case that goes to a tribunal, it is the tenant that's been wronged, and the tenant... Now, it doesn't mean that the tenant can't get assistance to take their case to the tribunal, which is quite different from actually being involved in it, but I do think the tenant has to be involved in the process. You know, that you can't have a local authority or an organisation going to the tribunal without the tenant's knowledge or wanting to be part of that. So I do think that while I don't think third parties should necessarily be taking the cases on behalf of the tenant to a tribunal, I do think the tenant should get assistance to make their case to the tribunal and be supported in making their application, can be accompanied to the tribunal to put their case forward. But I do think they have to be involved in the process. I think that's an important part of empowerment as well, that you have to involve the tenant in the process. And I say that in the absolute understanding, not just the point that you made, that some people will have other things to be doing at the time and getting a new tenancy, etc. But also, I think it's important that people who are unable to make their case and take their case to a tribunal can get accompanied and supported to do that. So, you know, I'm very, very keen that the tribunal system is accessible to everybody and people are encouraged to use it if they've been wronged or feel they've been wronged, but I do think they need to be part of the process.
Right. Well, this operational detail of the tribunal is still to be set out, Minister. Can you update the committee on any developments in this particular area?
I think from the end of 2016, I think the tribunal will be taking the private rented sector, current private rented sector cases will transfer to the tribunal by the end of 2016. We'll be consulting very soon on the operation of the tribunal, on the access to the tribunal, on the costs of the tribunal, whether there will be costs or not costs to the tribunal, how people can be represented at a tribunal. But I'm very clear that a tribunal system should be less formal and will be less formal than a court system. The tribunal members will be experts and will build up huge expertise in the subject matter that they're dealing with. And that anyone who goes to a tribunal, they should be able to go and represent themselves, but they should also be able to go with somebody, accompanied by someone, whether it be a lay representative or a family member or whoever, that can help them and speak in their behalf if they want to do it. And that's the way that, you know, I'm looking at the tribunal for the housing sector, but it's part, as you'll be aware of, you know, the all over, it's a Tribunal Scotland. But that's how we see it, and that's, you know, our clear intention. It's how we would want to take it forward. I don't know in terms of the update if there's anything else that you would wish to add, Kirsten.
No, they're currently out to consultation on various parts of the procedure, but there's more to be consulted upon.
There has been a question raised about access to legal aid. Would that be something that the consultation would cover? Do you have any preliminary views on that, Minister?
I have no preliminary views on it, and particularly if we're consulting on it at the moment. You know, I wouldn't want... What I am absolutely keen on is that people have representation if they wish, and whether that be a legal representative, whether it be a lay representative from a specialist organisation in the voluntary sector that deals with housing cases, because there's many experts out there. But I am quite keen and very keen that people have that level of representation if they wish to take their case to a tribunal. And there'll be expertise that will build up in that as well.
Okay. Thank you, Minister.
Okay, moving on, Mike.
Some of the stakeholders and committee witnesses have suggested that the rent pressure zone proposals won't address the underlying reason for rent increases, which they maintain is the problem of a lack of housing supply. And also, the Association of Local Authority Chief Housing Officers has suggested that these powers will not be widely used by local authorities. I wonder how the Minister feels about those comments.
I think the first thing, and I think I'm clear as well, and I think we're all very clear, that increasing housing supply across all tenures is the sustainable long-term solution to addressing the affordability of housing. In terms of the powers being used, it is a discretionary power, and it is up to local authorities to decide whether or not in their area or particular areas of their local authority, whether or not that they would wish to invoke these powers or use these powers if they feel that the pressure, the rent increases, is causing overall pressure within the whole housing system in their area, if increases are way above what is happening in the market. So it is up to local authorities. It's not up to the government to say to local authorities, use them or don't use them. It's up to local authorities to say, there is a discretionary power here. Is this useful? Is this a useful tool for you to use at a particular time in your local authority area? And that's the way we see it being used. We see it only being used in some areas across the country where others, the pressure's not there in the rents.
Thank you. And some witnesses have suggested to the committee that there's insufficient data on private rents for these proposals to be used effectively. Do you think this is correct? And could you also say how the data capture on private rents could be improved?
I don't know if I'm in a position at the moment to tell you how I think it can be improved. But certainly we do provide annual statistics on rent and, rents in various areas. It is 18 broad rental market areas, and I do appreciate that it might cover more than one area, could span more than one local authority. But it is quite robust data from the Rent Service markets database. Rent Service Scotland and the Tribunal will be publishing information on how they sent their rents as well. I think that's, maybe Barry will keep me right here, this is in the bill currently, that they will publish the data on how they set the rents and how they arrive at their decisions and make their determinations and adjudicating rents. And that will also help local authorities in determining whether or not in their area that they require to invoke the discretionary power.
Yeah, thank you. And the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors have suggested that rent capping will provide a level of uncertainty for investors, and that investors, and particularly corporate investors, will maybe deterred from investing in rent pressure zones. And bearing in mind your answer to my first question about the need to increase supply, particularly in these pressure zones, they suggest that it might have a contrary effect that ultimately would not be a good effect. Do you feel there's some merit in what their concerns?
I think it's the uncertainty they're concerned about. It's like I said at the very beginning, there's two sides to this. We have other investors telling us that what we have proposed, the current proposals, they don't see that as a disincentive to invest in the private sector. Because they're looking at the other things that we're introducing and trying to promote and getting the private sector to invest here. So they don't necessarily see that as being a disincentive. Others have said they feel it could be a disincentive because they're uncertain of to where it's going or how far it could go. But we're clear what we're proposing in this bill is proportionate. It responds to the spikes in particular areas if the rents are going at a huge increase. We don't think that will deter investment, and on balance we feel it's a proportionate measure and should be included in the bill.
Thank you. And my final question, Minister, is that the bill suggests that in the rent pressure zones the caps would only limit rent increases for sitting tenants but not for new tenants. And some of the stakeholders have suggested to us that they would like to see the rent caps or rent controls apply to new or initial tenancies as well. Do you feel that the measures are sufficient to give adequate protection for tenants?
I think they're proportionate. I think, you know, when we're talking about capping rents and looking at rents, it was very much about sitting tenants and the increase that they had. That is, in saying that, I'd said answer to your previous question, the answer to sustainable rents and affordability is increasing supply, and that's something that the Scottish Government's already announced that we will do in terms of affordable housing. What we're currently doing to attract investment into the private sector, getting more investment into the sector, more properties in the sector, will make the rents more affordable. So that's what we're consulting on, and that's what we're doing. I think taking it any further at this stage without... there isn't any evidence, that I don't think there's been sufficient evidence to suggest that we should be taking it any further. But also, I think it would take a lot more work and a lot more consultation than what we're intending to do with this bill. The core part of this bill is about security, stability for tenants and predictability in rent increases.
Okay. Thank you, Minister.
Okay. Minister, can I return to the issue that Adam Ingram raised earlier about the right of third parties to take an issue to the tribunal. I just want to be clear, and this is perhaps an issue more for the principal legal officer at the Scottish Government, that the provisions in this bill are consistent with other housing legislation. So the Housing Scotland Act 2014 made amendments to the Housing Scotland Act 2006 to allow third-party reporting rights for local authorities to the private rented housing panel. So is that provision the same as the provision that is proposed in this legislation?
I'm happy to provide an initial answer to that. It's slightly different. So the 2014 Act provides local authorities with the ability to report a breach of the repairing standard to the private rented housing panel that basically assess whether there's a breach and can issue enforcement notices on landlords where there is a breach. As part of that, they've got a new power to be able to inspect properties to determine whether or not the repairing standard has been met or not. So, in effect, a tenant can do that, and when commenced, a local authority will also be able to assess whether or not the repairing standard is met. They'll be able to report that to the landlord, and if the landlord doesn't take the appropriate action, then they'll be able to report that to the private rented housing panel. So that's very much about the condition of the property and the local authority's ability to themselves, independent of the tenant, assess whether that condition is meeting the appearing standard.
Okay, I can see the justification for that because of the particular circumstances that you've outlined. Okay, thank you for that. Can I move on to another issue, and that is the initial tenancy period? The bill proposes that there will be an initial tenancy period of 6 months unless the tenant and landlord have agreed on a shorter or longer initial period, as set out in section 52 of the bill. Some of the tenants' representative groups that we've heard evidence from, for example, Homeless Action Scotland and NUS Scotland, did not see a need for an initial tenancy period, Citizens Advice Scotland in the Living Rent campaign said that this could be a problem for some tenants, for example, in cases where a tenant is the subject of domestic abuse. I suppose my question, Minister, is in responding to these concerns, do you feel that the initial tenancy period provides sufficient flexibility for tenants?
I responded to a question, I think it was from Adam Ingram, on that, that we, in terms of the initial tenancy, I'm open to looking at that, looking at the grounds that we have for eviction and initial tenancies, but also looking at the flexibilities and the whole initial tenancy. And I'm very interested in the evidence we've had on it so far and what the committee might suggest on that. Is something that I'm willing to look at and I'm open to looking at.
Okay, that's helpful, Minister. It was just that one of the very specific examples that had been raised with the committee in evidence was a situation where a tenant is a subject of domestic abuse and needs to leave the property quickly. So clearly, you know, government would be sympathetic to taking any further measures to address that.
Part of the reason I saw that evidence that we'll look again at what we're proposing in initial tenancies and what we can do to kind of balance those fears that were suggested in the evidence.
Okay. My colleague Alec Johnson had raised or touched on the issue of the death of a tenant, and you had said that a bereaved partner should be able to succeed to the tenancy, but we would need to be careful that we didn't disadvantage either the family or the landlord in other circumstances. So I just wonder if you could say a little bit more about the
right.
The issue.
The bill as it currently stands, and I'll defer to my colleagues if I go way off key here, the bill as it currently stands allows a bereaved partner that's the tenancy is their principal home to succeed the tenancy. And if there is no bereaved partner, then under the current proposals in the bill, the family or the estate or the executor has to bring the tenancy to an end in a reasonable time. And if there is no executor, that someone dies intestate, then there would have to be an executor appointed. We have looked at the stakeholder evidence and representations in that, and think that that is not advantageous to a family who might have to spend money appointing an executor, using any money in an estate to bring a tenancy to an end. And secondly, we don't think that's fair to landlords either, so we've looked at that and intend bringing forward an amendment at stage two to bring the tenancy to an end on the death of someone if there's no one there to succeed the tenancy.
Okay, thank you, Minister. And finally, can you explain how the Bill's proposals tie in with other legislation affecting the private rented sector? And are you convinced the proposals are sufficiently connected to and coordinated with other elements of housing legislation?
I think they are, and I think I tried to kind of make that point in my opening speech, that this is part of what we're trying to do throughout the private sector to modernise the private sector. It kind of ties in with what we're doing in regulation of letting agents, what we're doing in issuing new statutory guidance on landlord enforcement, what we've done in the Housing Act as well. So I think all of that is just part of the picture that we are building for a modern private sector that houses 700,000 people in Scotland. And we've got to, you know, I'm very keen that people in the private sector can call the home they live in their home and can feel and believe it's their home as long as they, you know, pay their rent and abide by their good behaviour as you would as a good tenant, that they should be able to call that their home the way other people can do in other tenures. So that's what we're trying to do with this. And I think we're getting there. I think we're this is the kind of final part to put it in, is this modernised tenancy that's open-ended, that can give people confidence in the sector. They can, if they're not getting the repairs done, they can go to a tribunal, report it to tribunal without fear of losing their home while they're doing it. So I think it completes what we're trying to do within the private sector. And I think we've got it right.
Okay, thank you, Minister. Siobhan.
Minister, the Finance Committee took evidence from Glasgow City Council, who suggested that the methodology for identifying the rent pressure zones was more complicated than was suggested. They also questioned the basis of the financial memorandum, the suggestion that local authorities would only incur modest costs in respect of the pressure zones. I understand that the Bill team had offered to meet with the Council. Are you in a position to give this committee an update on how that meeting went and any conclusion?
Officials have met with the Council, Glasgow City Council, to talk about the private sector in a number of occasions, and including the rent pressure zones. So that's something we're looking at. This bill places no obligations on local authorities. It's a discretionary measure, the rent pressure zones. So we are not saying to local authorities, you must use this power. But of course, we will discuss with them if they come to us and say that this is something that we would find would be a useful power for us to use, but we can't do it because we're financially restricted, or we can't do it for a particular reason, then we would look at that and discuss that with them in more detail, and we'll continue to do that as we go through. But it is a discretionary power. The bill doesn't place any new, you know, obligations on local authorities. It's there for them to use if they feel that in their area this would be something that would be useful. And they'll be balancing what it costs them to do it to the benefits of actually invoking it as well. So we are still open to discussion with local authorities, and that will continue right through the process.
I appreciate your answer, Minister. I do, but on that specific one, have the Bill team met with the Council to discuss it on that specific issue? Because that's the information we've received from the Finance Committee. So I understand there'll be a lot of dialogue between yourselves and all local authorities on different parts of the Bill, but specifically on this.
I know officials have met, but I don't know if the Bill team per se have met.
Yeah.
Gary, would you like to answer that?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that. I met with Glasgow City Council with other colleagues a couple of weeks ago. As the Minister said, it was to discuss the Bill. Now it's been published, and they've had an opportunity to look at that in a bit more detail, as well as more broadly regulation of the private rented sector. Early discussions with them, they had some questions based on their initial take of the Bill, and I think that from the meeting that we've had, we've managed to reassure them now about some of the issues that they'd initially raised. But as the Minister said, the key point is that, subject to the will of Parliament and the Bill being passed, looking forward to the implementation of the bill, we'll continue to work with them. And if local authorities have matters they want to raise around implementation with them, and they think that there could be more assistance or help that we could provide them with, and that's something which, if it's a good case, we would be happy to discuss further with them.
Thank you.
Members, have any further questions? Minister or officials, do you have any further comments you'd like to make?
No, I don't think so.
Okay, in that case, can I thank the Minister and her officials for attending today's meeting. This has been our final oral evidence session on the Bill at Stage 1. The Committee expects to publish its Stage 1 report in January. I now move this meeting into private session. Thank you.